Hey all, welcome to homeschool. Hope everybody are doing good. And I am with the last chapter for MCQ series class 10. Almost all the chapters are completed. MCQ type of questions I discussed on every chapter that can be the most helpful videos for all the students who are going to write 2021 Karnataka SSLC board examination. Okay, say video links are provided in the description. If you have not yet watched, you can just go and watch them. And today I have come up with two chapters. One is sustainable management of natural resources. The other one is our environment. Both chapters are very simple. Altogether, two questions can be asked from both chapters. From our environment chapter, most of the topics are deleted for 2021 batch. I mean, everything about ecosystem, food chain, food web, everything is deleted. Only little part is there. I will revise now. And let me first revise sustainable management of natural resources. I will give you some key points. Okay, so it's better to note down those key points and try to understand those key points, because from these points, MCQ type of questions can be picked and asked. Okay, so concentrate. Let us revise. Let me revise first, and later I will discuss a few questions on the topic. Fine. Coming to the chapter, sustainable management of natural resources. See, first thing is try to understand the meaning of sustainable management of natural resources. It means that we have wonderful natural resources like water, forest, land, air, you know, all of them have to be used in a limited way. Okay, you should not overuse them, and you should manage the usage of these resources. Why? It's because when you protect them, they will protect you, isn't it? And they should be available for our future generation in a pure form. Right? If you have used everything now in your generation, you know, they will not be available for your future generation. Whereas that is not good, right? In the nature. So you have to use them in a limited way. You have to use them and manage them in a consistent way so that they can be available in the purest form for your generation as well as for the future generation. Okay, so this is what we mean by sustainable management of natural resources. Okay, and the very first concept that you have to remember in a chapter is about, you know, the pollution of Ganga River. So you need to know something about the pollution of Ganga River, Ganga. See, mainly Ganga River gets polluted by a bacteria called coliform. So Ganga River is getting polluted majorly by a bacteria called coliform bacteria. Okay. See, how is this coliform bacteria entering into Ganga River? By what activities coliform is going into a Ganga River? It is by, you know, dumping corpse. So what do you mean by corpse? Corpse in the sense dead bodies. Okay. Say most of the dead bodies are dumped into a Ganga River. This is one reason, as well as, you know, dumping animal excreta. Okay. So animal excreta, when it gets added to Ganga River, then also Ganga River gets polluted by this coliform bacteria. So usually this coliform bacteria is present in human intestine. Okay. It is present in human intestine. So when you dump a dead body or when animal excreta gets added to Ganga River, you know, this coliform bacteria can be added to Ganga River, and then we say Ganga River is polluted. Okay. This is a disease causing bacteria. So when a person drinks a water containing this coliform bacteria, he gets diseases. So disease causing bacteria. So to decrease this kind of pollution, you know, government has come up with a project called Ganga Action Plan. Ganga Action Plan. plan in the year 1985. Okay, so what is the main purpose of Ganga Action Plan? It is to protect or it is to clean Ganga. Okay, so this is the major main motto of Ganga Action Plan. Okay, so these are a few things that you have to remember about the pollution of Ganga and Ganga Action Plan. Okay, fine. And the next concept that is very, very important is the 5 R's. We have studied the 5 R's to save environment. So can you all able to recall what are the 5 R's to save the environment? Yes. We have something called refuse. Okay, refuse, reduce, reuse, repurpose, and recycle. Isn't it? Recycle. So these are the 5 R's. And you must also know their meaning. What do you mean by refuse? Refuse means, so first you tell no to a particular thing that is harming environment, right? Say for example, if it is a plastic, try telling no to plastic first. That is what? First you refuse using those things which are harmful to the environment. And what do you mean by reduce? In case if you cannot refuse it, you try to reduce. Okay, say use to a minimum extent the substances that are causing pollution to the environment. And next is reuse. In case if you have used it, try to reuse it. Say for example, when you use thick plastic bags, when you don't have an option except a thick plastic bags, okay, you can use it again and again, right? Say that is what we mean by reuse. Right, and then repurpose. Say after reusing, if you have to throw it, please don't throw and make another use out of it. Okay, say for example, broken ceramics, if it is there, you can join and make it as a beautiful pot, decorative items, right? So that's what we mean by repurpose. Okay, we are using one item for another purpose. Clear? That is what we mean by repurpose. And then recycle. Say all these plastics after many times of usage, you know, you will dump it in one place and they will get recycled, right? So again, a new type of plastic can be generated out of that, or any other material can be generated out of that. That's what we mean by recycle. Okay, say actually repurpose is repurpose or any other thing, or reduce or reuse is better than recycle. Okay, because recycle involves a consumption of energy, right? It involves the consumption of technology or energy. So repurpose or reuse is always better than recycle. Okay, so all these points you have to be aware of, the 5 R's to save the environment. Not just remembering what are 5 R's, you must know which is better than which, and you must know their exact meanings behind them. Clear? Fine. And the next concept that we study in a chapter is about forest and wildlife, isn't it? See, we say that forests are biodiversity hotspot. So don't forget this word. Forests are called biodiversity hotspots. Can you tell me why do forests are called as biodiversity hotspots? Because forest is the area where you will find lots of animal species and plant species. Many varieties of animal species and plant species are found in forest, right? So that is why they are called biodiversity hotspots. So try to understand this meaning. And here one more important thing that you have to remember is the 4 stakeholders of the forest. So who are the 4 stakeholders of the forest? The first one is people in and around the forest. The people who live in and around the forest are called stakeholders of forest. What do you mean by stakeholders? Stakeholders is people you know, who can depend on a forest and who can protect the forest? Mainly the people who can protect the forest, save the forest, and who depend on the forest. Okay. So the people who have involvement with the forest is called, you know, stakeholders. So the first stakeholders are the people who live in and around the forest, like tribals. Okay. So why do we call them as a stakeholder? Because these people completely dependent on the forest for their shelter and food, mainly for their shelter and food, right? And these are the people who can actually protect the forest. If somebody have come for cutting a tree, you know, these people will object that, right? Say somehow they are trying to protect the forest because they completely dependent on forest, right? So these guys are the first stakeholders of forest. And next is forest department. So forest department. See, how does the forest department is called as stakeholders of forest? See, the forest land is owned by the forest department. The land is owned by the government, right? So all the forest land belongs to forest department, that is government. So you know, to some extent these government people have to protect the forest, right? That's why we call even the forest department as one of the stakeholders of forest. And next is industrialist. Industrialists are also stakeholders of forest. Why? Because industrialists use the forest to produce, right, for various purposes. Forest to produce in the sense the raw materials for their industries are, you know, obtained from forest. Say various raw materials like wood and tinder and everything, they get it from forest, right? Say to some extent, even these guys are dependent on the forest. That's the reason they are one of the stakeholders of forest. And coming to the last stakeholder, wildlife enthusiast. Wildlife enthusiast. Okay. So who are wildlife enthusiasts? The people who always try to protect the forest on their own, right? Say they work as volunteers and they work on their own to protect the forest. Or I can say they are nature lovers or animal lovers, right? And they always try to save the animals or protect the forest. So to some extent, they are also the stakeholders of forest. So try to remember the four stakeholders of forest. Clear? This is another important aspect of the chapter that you have to remember. And next we will go for some instances or some examples where people's participation have really protected the forest. Okay, say Bishnoi community, and you know, we have studied Chipko movement and all that. We will try to revise what actually we mean by the Bishnoi community and how they protected the forest. So there are certain examples where the tribals or the people tried to protect the forest, right? So those instances or the examples we are going to revise now. You can look at the points on a board, guys. So these are the three instances or three examples where people participation you will observe in protecting the forest. Okay, so in different areas, the people who were living in the forest have protected the forest by doing, you know, various activities. Clear? And you see the first example, Bishnoi community. Okay, so this was done in Rajasthan. Okay, near Jodhpur. Okay, Bishnoi community is a tribal community who is to worship a set of trees called Kejri trees. Okay, so Kejri tree is a sacred tree for Bishnoi community. So it was in 1731, few of the industrialists started demolishing these Kejri trees for some construction purposes. So there came a lady called Amruta Devi Bishnoi with 363 other village people, sacrificed their lives in protecting Kejri trees. Okay, so this is what one of the instances where people have participated in saving the forest, in saving the trees, right? So try to remember which is the tree, Kejri tree, which is a sacred tree for which community? Bishnoi community. And which lady have fought against it? It is Amruta Devi Bishnoi in the year 1731. Remember where it happened? A village near Jodhpur in Rajasthan. Okay, say that's the reason. Every year for the people who fights for protecting forest, you know, they are awarded with Amruta Devi Bishnoi Award, okay, in honor of this particular lady. And second example, try to remember, we all know this, right? Chipko Andolan, that is Hug the Tree movement, that was also done to protect the forest, where it is done in the village Gharwal in Himalayas. Okay, and the third instant is, you know, the government people failed to revive the Sal forest in West Bengal. That's the reason a person called A.K. Banerjee with other villagers, you know, he revived, I mean, he brought back how much of hectares of forest? You know, 1,272 hectares of forest land was protected and he brought back that particular land. Okay, so this is another example. So degradation of Sal forest, where in West Bengal was, protected, okay, by this particular person. And second one is Chipko Andolan, which was done in Himalayas. First one is Bishnoi community, right? So these are the different instances that you can remember. So this is all about forest and wildlife. And now coming to another aspect of the chapter, that is water for all. Water for all. Okay. So here first thing you learned about is dams. Okay. So what do you mean by a dam? We all know it's a big water reservoirs that is constructed across big rivers, right? So why do we construct dam? Is because mainly for the irrigation, right? Mainly for the irrigation and also for the drinking water facility. And according to it, it's been built for the benefit of man's needs, isn't it? Okay, but there is lots of opposition in construction of dams in many of the areas. Say two oppositions you have to remember, that is there in our syllabus, right? Say one is opposition during theory dam construction, right? So theory dam construction, which was done across the river Ganga, right? Say people have opposed to construct this theory dam across Ganga. And another one is Sardar Sarovar water project. Sardar Sarovar project that was constructed near the river Narmada. Okay, say during the construction of these dams, people have opposed a lot. It's because of various problems. Okay, what are the three problems that arises during the construction of dams? See, I am going to talk about three major problems that arises during the construction of dams. Say you have to neatly understand the meanings behind these problems, guys. So first, second and third, there are three major problems. One is social problems, we say, right? And the second one is economical problems. And the third one is environmental problems. So what do you mean by social problem? Say a large area is required to construct a dam, where in that particular area, many of the people and many of the plant species would be living, right? And to construct a dam, you must evacuate those people from that area. You must cut all the trees from that area. So it would disturb the ecosystem that is present in that area. Especially the people who were living in that area have to go to another place, right? Say, and many of them would lose their lives, and government have failed to give the rehabilitation center for those particular people. Say, government have to show one more place for those people who are living in that area, but government had failed in giving a new place for those people. So what about the lives of those people who were living in that area? This is what comes under social problems. Say, rehabilitation of the people who are living in that area is not properly being done by the government people. Okay, fine. And second one is economical problems. Economical problems is what constructing a dam involves lots of power, okay, lots of energy and manpower. And it's too much costly, right, to construct a dam. That's what we mean by economical problems. Say, simply government have to use its money, power, manpower, energy and everything to construct a dam, right? That is economical problem. And coming to the last problem, that is environmental problem. As I have already told you, lots of trees and lots of vegetation, one particular ecosystem only would be there in that area, right? Say, if you want to construct a dam, you have to demolish everything, right? Say, many of the plant species would be killed and many of the animal species would become extinct. It becomes vanished, right? Say, this is all about the environmental problems. So these are the three problems we have to face in case if we are constructing dams across the big rivers, right? If we can cope up with these problems, if we can give enough justice to the people who are living there, you know, somehow we can construct a dam easily. But then, you know, finally a big vegetation, a big ecosystem that is living in that area would be completely demolished, right? So this is what you have to remember for MCQ type of questions. And after this, you must also know about water harvesting techniques. Okay, that is another important thing for MCQ type of questions. Let's discuss about water harvesting techniques, what and all the points that we have to remember. See guys, we have also studied something called watershed management, isn't it? So what is the main purpose of watershed management? It is to increase the biomass. It is to conserve the soil and forest mainly, okay? The major purpose of watershed management is listed here. You can observe the 3 points. It helps to increase the biomass. That means the plant species and animal species can get increased day by day, okay? And next one is it increases the income of watershed community, right? Say a set of local community people's income also can be increased. And the other one is increases life of downstream dam and reservoir. You know, near the dam and reservoirs, since there is water, you can observe the development of many animal and plant species. Okay, say these are the meanings of these 3 important points. Okay, so these are the purposes, the main purposes of watershed management. Clear? And next, very, very important for MCQ type of questions is ancient water harvesting techniques. Okay, say from the olden days onwards in different states, different water harvesting techniques have been used. And there are different names for those water harvesting techniques in different states, right? Say for example, we call khadins and nadis in which state? Rajasthan. So water harvesting techniques have been called with these names in Rajasthan. And next, bandaras and thals in Maharashtra. We call water harvesting technique as bandis in Madhya Pradesh as well as in Uttar Pradesh. Ahars and pines in Bihar. Kuls, we call with the name Kuls in Himachal Pradesh. Eris in Tamil Nadu, Surangams in Kerala, Kattas in Karnataka. So these are the water harvesting techniques names in different states. So try to remember this, okay, for MCQ type of questions. And coming to this particular concept, the last concept of the chapter, you know, usually water harvesting structures are built in a crescent shape. So you have a diagram in your textbook, you can observe that. They are built in a crescent shape, okay? Say, why they are built in a crescent shape? Why they have also built different types of check dams, right? Say, water harvesting structures will also have small check dams. the purpose of these structures built in a crescent shape is, you know, to recharge groundwater. It is not only to hold the surface water, you know, they have built in a crescent shape because to recharge the groundwater. This is the, you know, one of the most important point that you have to remember. See, the main purpose of water harvesting technique is to recharge groundwater. That's the reason they will build harvesting structures in crescent shape. Okay, fine. And now, okay, to recharge the groundwater. Now, what are the advantages of groundwater? Why we need to have groundwater in our earth? That's because I have listed few reasons here. You can note it down. See, groundwater do not evaporate. Surface water, evaporation is very high. Whereas groundwater do not evaporate. That is one advantage of groundwater. The other one is it can provide moisture for the vegetation. Okay, and it do not provide breeding grounds for mosquitoes. This is very important. See, when you have a stagnant water, you know, mosquitoes will develop. They breed in that stagnant water. But whereas in the groundwater, mosquitoes will not develop. And then they are protected from contamination. Yes, see, animal waste and plant waste do accumulate in a stagnant water, but in a groundwater you don't find any animal and plant waste. So they are groundwater is somewhat protected from contamination. Okay, and it also helps in recharging small wells. Clear? So these are the different advantages of groundwater. Clear? What is the main purpose of water harvesting technique and why they are built in crescent shape? It is to recharge groundwater rather than holding a surface water. Okay, so this is all about the chapter Sustainable Management of Natural Resource. Hope this has given enough benefit for you to recall the concepts and to answer MCQs with utmost confidence, right? And now let me recall the topic that is there in our environment and then we will go for the questions. See guys, in our environment chapter, you need to understand only two subtopics. What are they? One is about ozone layer, okay, and its depletion. You need to understand about its depletion. And the second one is garbage waste management. Okay, so managing garbage waste. So these are the two topics you have to study, right? Definitely one question can be asked from this particular chapter. Now let me revise about ozone layer and its depletion. See here, how is ozone layer formed? How ozone formula O3, oxygen means O2, ozone is what? O3, right? O3 means ozone. So how ozone is formed? Say you have a small chemical reaction, try to understand that. Normally, oxygen, when it goes to a higher level in the atmosphere, this will break down in presence of UV rays. This will break down in presence of UV rays. Remember guys, UV rays are from sun. Okay, when oxygen, excess oxygen which is there in the atmosphere goes little up, okay, in presence of UV rays, this O2 will break down into O and O. Okay, two nascent, we call this as nascent oxygen in chemical language. So two oxygen atoms you will get. And what happens? One of the oxygen will again react with O2. There would be large amount of O2. Few O2 molecules will break. Few O2 molecules will remain like that only. Right? So this one of the nascent oxygen would react with O2 and you will get O3. So that is how ozone layer is formed above the atmosphere. Okay. So what is the use of ozone layer? Use of ozone layer. Okay, so why ozone layer is very, very important? This ozone layer will protect the earth from UV radiations. From UV radiations. Okay, so usually UV radiations when reaches earth, it will damage animals and plants nature. Okay, especially in the humans we get skin cancer. Okay, so UV radiations damages animal skin. Okay, we are also animals only, right? See, normally it leads to skin cancer. It's very dangerous for plants and animals, right? So our earth have to be protected from UV radiations. So who is there? Who is the protecting layer that is protecting the earth from UV radiations? It is ozone layer. Okay, so ozone layer is very, very important. Clear? It will always protect the earth from UV radiations. Why UV radiations are dangerous? It will damage plants and animals. Okay, especially in the humans, it causes skin cancer. Clear? And why ozone layer is depleting? Why ozone layer depleting? Depleting in the sense, why it is getting destroyed? Okay, say ozone layer is getting holes. You know, there is a formation of holes in the ozone layer nowadays. That's what we mean by ozone layer is getting destroyed or depleting. So what is the reason for this? The reason is chlorofluorocarbons. In short, we say it as CFCs. Okay, so what is CFCs? Chlorofluorocarbons. Okay, so where do we use these chemicals? These chemicals are used in refrigerators and fire extinguishers. Okay, so in these instruments, these chemicals are used. So when these chemicals are released into atmosphere, they will go up to the ozone layer and they will react with this ozone. Okay, so they will chemically react with this ozone and ozone will get converted into something else. Now it is no more a ozone layer, right? So that's how, due to some chemical reactions with ozone, by these chemicals, you will find holes in the ozone layer. That's how we say ozone layer is getting depleted. Okay. Say that is the reason United Nations Environmental Program. Okay. So there is an organization, United Nations Environmental Program. And these people have banned usage of chlorofluorocarbons. Okay. In refrigerators and fire extinguishers. So they have replaced these chemicals with another chemicals to use in these instruments. Okay, these electrical appliances. That's what about ozone layer. So what is important? How ozone is formed is important. Okay, remember UV radiations are helpful for the formation of ozone. And what is the use of ozone layer? And why UV radiations are dangerous if it comes onto the earth? And later, why ozone layer is getting destroyed, why it is getting depleting. Okay, that is important. It is due to CFCs, that is chlorofluorocarbons. Where do you find chlorofluorocarbons? In these particular appliances. Okay, fine. And now, the second one is managing garbage waste. You know what? Garbage waste can be categorized into two categories. Okay, one is biodegradable, and another one is non-biodegradable. See guys, we will have different types of waste in garbage, right? So we can divide the entire waste into two main categories. One is biodegradable. That means they are safe to environment. Biodegradable in the sense, here, this particular waste can undergo decomposition in the soil by a bacteria, right? So they are okay for the environment. They do not cause any harm to the environment. They do not cause any pollution, right? Can you all tell me the examples of biodegradable waste? It is all your animal waste, right? Plant waste, vegetable waste, fruit peels, you know, all these are biodegradable waste. They are decomposed in the soil by bacteria. Okay. And non-biodegradable waste, the best example is plastic all types of plastic. You know, this plastic, when you throw it on a ground, it will remain for a number of years. It will not undergo decomposition, right? Instead of that, it can release some poisonous gases over the years, and that may cause pollution in the environment, right? So they would ask a question like this. So they'll give you a set of three materials, and they'll ask you which among them is a biodegradable, which among them is non-biodegradable, right? So this type of questions can be asked. Say I have one question which I deal now, so that you will get a better idea. Okay, so this is all about the chapter Our Environment. Nothing much to learn for this year, that is for 2021 examination. Only this much you can remember about Our Environment. It is more than enough. Okay, and now let us have a look at few questions that I collected from both chapters, that is Sustainable Management as well as Our Environment. I have around 14 to 15 questions. Let us discuss them. Look at the first question here, guys. Khadins, bandis, ahars, kattas are emission structures that is example for grain storage, hood storage, water harvesting, soil conservation. Definitely, just now we have discussed, they are all emission water harvesting techniques, right? So for your first question, option C is your answer. See, most of the questions from these two chapters will be direct, so you no need to worry too much. Only if you can revise the concept that I have explained so far is more than enough, okay, to answer any question from this chapter. Second question, you have to listen carefully this question. The main cause for abundant coliform bacteria in River Ganga is, look at the options, disposal of corpse and animal excreta into water, discharge of effluents from electroplating industries, washing of clothes, all. See here, you will get confused between the first option and D option, A option and D option, right? Actually, pollution of Ganga River is due to all the three. It is by disposal of dead bodies and animal waste. It is by discharge of harmful chemicals from electroplating industry. And it is also by washing clothes. Right, pollution is caused by all, but which pollution? They have specifically mentioned coliform bacteria is developed, that way the pollution is caused in Ganga. So how is coliform bacteria is developed in Ganga? It is definitely by option A, right? That is by dumping dead bodies or by adding animal excreta. Isn't it? Say human intestines contain coliform bacteria and it will reach water through animal excreta mainly. So that is the major pollution that we are doing to River Ganga, and that is the main reason why coliform bacteria is increasing in Ganga River. Okay, so definitely here not D as answer, it is option A as answer. So for the second question, option A is answer. Clear? Coming to third question, very simple. The three R's that will help us to conserve natural resources for long-term use are, what are the three R's? Recycle, see we actually have five R's, right? Let us revise. Reduce, refuse, reuse, repurpose and recycle. Okay, so three R's they asked you. So which are the three R's in the options? First option, recycle, regenerate, reuse. Regenerate is not a word that we studied, right? B option also has the word regenerate, so you can neglect. C option has the word redistribute, neglect. D option, reduce, reuse, recycle. Definitely, these are the three R's that you can consider, right? So for third question, option D is your answer. Fourth question. Opposition to the construction of large dams is due to, I mentioned, what are the three problems that gets arises when you construct large dams? One is social problems, economical problems and environmental problems. So where is the option mentioned? Option D you see, all, right? So definitely for fourth question, option D is the answer. Coming to fifth question. The Chipko Andolan originated from, you have to remember the places, guys. So where is Chipko Andolan originated? It is in Garhwal village in Himalayas, isn't it? So where is Garhwal is mentioned? It is in option B. So for fifth question, option B is the correct answer. Coming to sixth question. Canal irrigation system called Kuls had evolved in. So Kuls is one of the water harvesting technique, okay, using canals, by digging canals. So Kuls is the technique that is adopted in which state? Definitely in Himachal Pradesh, that is HP, right? So for sixth question, the answer is option A. Seventh question. Following is the advantage of water stored in ground. So what is the advantages of groundwater? We have studied number of advantages. I gave a list, right? So let us just select the option. Option A, it does not evaporate. Yes, that is one of the advantage. B, it spreads out to recharge wells. Yes, groundwater helps in recharging wells. I gave you that point. Third one, it provides moisture to vegetation over a wide area. Correct. This is also one of the point. Option D, it has to be option D. Okay, it mentioned as A. It has to be option D, all. So all is the correct answer, right? So for seventh question, option D, it has printed as A. Don't get confused. It is D. So D, all is correct answer. Question number eight. The purpose of rainwater harvesting is for, so what is the use of harvesting technique? What is the use of rainwater harvesting technique? It is to recharge groundwater. Remember this point. So where is that point mentioned? It is mentioned in option D, isn't it? So for eighth question, option D is the correct answer. Ninth one. Amruta Devi Bishnoi sacrificed her life to protect which trees? Kejri trees. In which place? Rajasthan. Yes or no? So, Kejri trees, where is the option mentioned? B. So, for ninth question, B is the answer. Next, for tenth question. Which of the following is the biodiversity hotspots? Definitely, forests are called as biodiversity hotspot. And this question, you will observe in one of the model papers also. Okay. So, very, very important MCQ, I can tell. Coming to 11th question. Which of the following is the age-old concept of water harvesting system in Madhya Pradesh? Bandis. Yes or no? We call bandis as the name for water harvesting technique in Madhya Pradesh. So option A is answer. For 11th question, option A is your answer. Coming to 12th question, read all the sentences carefully and then answer. Among the statements given below, select the ones that correctly describe the concept of sustainable development. Okay, so they have given four sentences. Which of them correctly explains the meaning of sustainable development? First statement. Planned growth with minimum damage to the environment. Yes, this means sustainable development. Okay, you have to plan the growth so that the damage that occurs in the environment should be minimum. Okay. Second one, growth irrespective of the extent of damage caused to the environment. No, you have to consider the environment, right? Fine. So first one you can consider. Second one, no. Third sentence, you see, stopping all developmental work to conserve the environment. No, development is also necessary for a human life, right? For any other animal life. So keep the environment in mind and then start thinking over developmental works. Okay, it's not that you have to completely stop developmental works to conserve environment. So option three, you can eliminate. Option four, growth that is acceptable to all the stakeholders. Yes. when you are doing some development with respect to a forest, you know, that development must be accepted by all stakeholders. You have to convince all stakeholders. So that is correct only. So first statement and fourth statement is relating to sustainable development. So where is the option mentioned? Yes, option A is correct answer. So for 12th question, option A is correct answer. And coming to 13th question, it's on our environment chapter that I selected. Which of the following groups contain only biodegradable items? So this is a very common question that you can expect from our environment. Okay, so can you select which option has only biodegradable items? Option A, grass biodegradable, flowers biodegradable, plastic. No, it's non-biodegradable. Exclude option A. Option B, you see, grass biodegradable, wood biodegradable, plastic. No, plastic is not biodegradable. Okay. C, fruit peels biodegradable, grass biodegradable, lime juice, yes, biodegradable. So definitely for 13th question, option C is answer. Okay, all the three are biodegradable. Let's see the fourth option also. Cake, grass, bakelite. Bakelite is a form of plastic. Okay, it's not a biodegradable. Fine. Coming to the last question. The excessive exposure of humans to UV rays result in damaged immune system, skin cancer, peptic ulcers, damage to lungs. I told you many times, I repeated, UV radiations damage our skin. It leads to skin cancer. Okay, so what is the answer? For 14th question, B is your correct option. Okay, so with this, I have completed all the science chapters, MCQs with the best explanation, right? All the video links are provided in the description. If you have not watched, go to the links and watch. So with this, I have completed all the topics that is very much necessary to write examination for 2021 batch, okay, in the MCQ format. And very soon, maybe within a week, I will come up with certain tips that you have to follow during examination, right? And I'll tell you how to manage your OMR sheet and how to manage your time, etc. So certain tips I'll be sharing with you regarding the examinations and various subjects. So meet you up in that video. Till then, take care, revise all topics carefully. The entire content is there in a channel. Use the content to a maximum extent and get very good marks from your side. Thank you so much, and subscribe our channel to learn the concepts in the easiest way and in a detailed way. Thank you.